Well, can you all see the screen clearly?
Yes, sir.
So this is what we discussed last week. We arrive here, right, at the governing differential equations. The first derivative of the, this is normal force actually, internal normal force in balance with the axially distributed force, okay? So the problem is like this, given the geometry of the bar like this, modulus elasticity, and then cross-flow area, and then alpha is the coefficient of thermal expansion, and then the temperature change, also the mechanical loads, this is the concentrated load at the right end, and then actually distributed force like this. The problem is how to determine the displacements, okay, and then strain and stress, also given of course the boundary conditions here, okay. Well, we use these equations together with boundary conditions, okay, in order to solve this problem. So before moving forward, I will just summarize what we discussed last week, right? Last week we discussed three basic equations governing the axial deformation of the bars. What is that? What are they? First, the equation connecting the displacement and strain. That's called kinematic equations. The second one, connecting the strain with the stress or the resultant of the stress, that's the normal force. That's called constructive equations. And then the third one is connecting the internal force and the external force. That's the equilibrium equations. All of these equations are applicable on the internal point in the bar, right? But how about at the bar, at the end of the bars, at the ends of the bar, we have another information. That's called boundary conditions. The boundary conditions can be essential boundary conditions. That's the displacement boundary condition. In this example, is fixed means zero. The displacement at the left end is zero. How about at the right end? The information at the right end is the not the displacement, but the force. That's called force boundary condition. Okay. The normal force at the right end is P. So either displacement or force, but not both at the same point. Okay. The information. That's make the equation complete for solving the problem. Okay, let give an example. For example, let's suppose that the bar is prismatic. What is prismatic? It means the cross-flow area is constant along the bar, and then made from a homogeneous material. What does it mean? Homogeneous, it means the same material for each point, right? So this and this the same. Of course, that's cause the same E alpha, right? It means E alpha constants along the bar. And furthermore, to make the problem easier, let's say the distributed force is also constants, or in other words, that's uniformly distributed axial force. This is just a number, not a function, okay? Or in other words, constants, and then concentrated force, and then also let's say undergoes a constant or uniform temperature change, so the temperature change along the bar remains the same. Let's say T, okay. Let's say from 20 to 25, it means increase 5 degrees, okay. Let's say that we have these situations. For this problem, the differential equation applicable on the interior of the bar, that's from x from 0 to L, right, is reduced to this one. you can prove by yourself, okay? That's the initial differential equations, this one. Because this is constant, we can put here. So this is because the secondary derivative to constant is zero, right? So we have this one. Okay, now to solve the problem, let's begin by integrating these equations. Let's put plus p to become minus p on the right hand side here, and then integrate. We integrate. It means take the anti-derivative. Okay, the derivative. We have this is the second become the first derivative. AE are just a number or constants, so it doesn't have any influence. So this is the integration of this one. We have an integration constant C1. How to obtain C1? How to determine C1? Usually, the unknown constants we can determine from the boundary conditions. Because this is, we know that this is normal force, A, E du dx is strain, right? This is normal force. It seems that the appropriate boundary condition is on the right. That's force on Newman boundary conditions. That says that, okay, on the right end is this one is P. So this is on the right end is what? X equal L, right? It's X equal L. Yes, like this, and then minus P. This is boundary condition the right end. Sorry, this is the boundary condition the right end. We have the boundary condition the right end information like this. So put X equal L here. Okay, and then take the information from the boundary conditions that on the right end should be this one. So from here, we can obtain the unknown C1, unknown constant C1, just this one plus BL. So we have this one, right? We now know the C1, so minus PX plus this plus the C1, plus C1. We have this one, okay? Not yet finished because we want to know the displacement field, right? U. How to obtain that? Integrate one more time, okay? Integrating this one more time become U. Px, this is constant x, this is px, this is 1/2 x squared, plus another integration constant c2. Because you know when we take antiderivative, we always have integration constants. This time, how to obtain the unknown constants, the integration constants? Any idea? What kind of information that we can use to obtain C2? Of course, the second information before we use on the right, now on the left. How about on the left? At x0, what happened? The displacement zero. Okay, so put x0, all become zero, right? Impose the boundary conditions. From here we get, because if we plug in zero to here, all zero, and then the information is that the displacement is zero on the right, so C2 is zero, so the solution is this one. So this is the displacement field, axial displacement field, or axial deformation field, right? Axial displacement, it means give informations. For example, if we want to know how about the displacement of this cross section, this is before and then after deformation it moves right to here. It's given by depend on the position. For example, this is 0.4L. For example, they just put this number to here, and then we will get the result right. That's the displacement as function of position of the cross section. So this is axial displacement of the not only at the one point, but that's the displacement of one cross section, because you know the basic assumption of the bar that the cross section plane remain plane before and after deformation. A plane cross section before deformations remain plane. It means this U is not only displacement of a certain material point, but the whole cross section. Once we know the displacement field, it's easy to obtain, for example, strain. Just take the derivative, we get this one. And then also easy to obtain the stress. Just use the positive equations and then we get this one. If we want to know the exact normal force distributions, just multiply sigma with the A, crossal area. Usually of our interest or an engineer interest is what? Usually an engineer want to know what's the maximum displacement. The maximum displacement for this problem is at x equal L. So just plug in L into x here. This is the maximum displacement at the right end. How about the stress? Maximum stress occurs here. Okay. Also the normal force at the left end. So this is given by plug in zero here, get the maximum normal force. So this is the valuable numbers, valuable figures for an engineer for designing, for example, this tension bar. Okay. Any questions regarding this simple example? So if we know the governing equations, we can solve it because this is simple problem. What I talk here is a simple problem, so we can solve it analytically or exactly. In general, for other problems other than bar, or even for bar, when it becomes too complicated, for example, the loading is too complicated and the boundary conditions not here, it's sometimes, or maybe the cross-sectional area is not smooth like this, okay? It's in many occasions it's very difficult to solve the differential equation, okay? Maybe not difficult, just cumbersome for this problem, but later we can use finite element to solve this problem easily, okay? But before I proceed to another example that actually we have discussed already last week, any questions? If you have any questions regarding how to solve this problem, no? Okay, the second example. I think this is already last week, okay? I just add one example. That's the first example. Now the second example. This is non-prismatic bar. The first example is prismatic because the cross-sectional area constants along the bar, but this time is not prismatic. Okay, there are two questions for this problem. First, find the exact solutions. Actually, already last week, right? For the displacement U, displacement field, strain, and stress. And then compare to the finite element solutions. Okay. That's the second, maybe this is the second question, compare to the finite element solutions. Well, again, how to solve this problem? Take a look at the governing equations, the differential equations. For this problem, there is no axially distributed force. In other words, P, the axially distributed force is zero and there is no temperature change. So the differential equations becomes this one, okay? But the difficulty here is that the cross-sectional area is not constant. In other words, it's a function. We should be able to express the cross-sectional area as a function of the coordinates, okay? And just use simple mathematics to form these functions. Okay, it means the cross-sectional area begins from here, if x0 it's 3, right? 3a0. It xl, x equal l, this become olt, x equal to lt becomes 1 a0. So the causal varies linearly. Boundary condition, how about boundary conditions? I think the boundary condition is easy, the same as just the previous problem. This one, this is displacement boundary condition, this is force boundary condition on the right hand, right? So this is x at x equals 0, this is at x equal to l. This is normal force actually. AE or EA UDX is nothing but this is normal. It means that the normal force at the right hand is F. How to solve this problem? Again, just integrate, okay? First, we have this equation, integrating this one time, okay? Please be careful. The integration of zero, antiderivative of zero, in general is not zero, but a constant. Because if we have constants, we take derivative is zero, right? So the general solution for antiderivative of zero is a constant, not zero. How to obtain this zero? You know already, right? Just take the information regarding the boundary condition the right end. At the right end, the information is given like this. It means what? Oh, this is constant, but this is F. So we know that C1 is F. Okay, from here we can change the form. We divide this equation by AE, become like this. So I should plug in this one, okay? And then recall that what is A? A is this one, right? So plug in this into this one. So we have this one. So the corresponding area is not a constant, but a function. So this is the function given by that one. F constants, A zero constant, E constant, but A is not constant. Here it is the A, okay? Putting this into, plug in this expression into this one, then we have this. Okay, next, what should we do? First, simplify this one, okay? How to simplify? Does multiply the numerator and denominator by LT, L sub T, okay? And then we obtain, this is the numerator become F L sub T, and not E 3L sub T minus 2X. Okay, to obtain U, of course, we can take the antiderivative or integrals. Okay, indeterminate integrals. Since this is constants, these are constants, right? F, L sub T, A naught, E. So we can take it out from the integrals. What remains inside integral is this one. How to integrate this? That's calculus, right? From calculus, we know that integration of the rational function 1 over something, the degrees of this something is for sure natural logarithm, okay? Natural logarithm functions of this one multiply by 1 minus over this one, plus, don't forget, an integration constant, the second integration constant. How to obtain this? From displacement boundary condition on the left end. At the left end, that's when x0, this become this one, right? What happened on the left end? The displacement is u is 0. So from here, we can obtain c2. Okay, this becomes 0. Or in other words, c2 is equal to 1/2 natural log 3 L sub t. We found the integration constants. So we plug in into this. That's become the solution, right? That become the solutions. And then simplify the expressions using the properties of the natural logarithm to become like this. So this is the final expressions for the displacement of what? Of any cross-section along the bar at position x. This is called displacement field. Axial displacement field of the bar. This is exact solution. we can use this to assess, to evaluate the finite element solution method. Okay. Once we know the displacement, it's easy to obtain the strain. Okay, just take the first derivative, and then stress. If you want also axial force, just multiply this with A. Okay, A. Not A naught, A. AX, okay, AX. Because recall that in this problem, A, the coastline area, is function of X. Any questions so far? Is it clear? Well, what I'm talking here is not finite element. This is just illustration that we can use the governing equations, examples that we can use the governing equation to solve the problem, because the problem is quite easy, right? In general, finite element is directed towards difficult problems where we cannot solve the differential equations analytically. It's good that I take the example of bars because that's simple, right? So if an engineer, what the interest of an engineer? Usually they interested to find the maximum, the extreme values of the displacement. Here, just put or plug in the LT here, and then we got that this is become 3, right? Natural log of 3. Natural log of 3. Divided by 2 FLT A not E. That's here. What's the maximum force? Here, of course. Okay. That's the maximum stress is F divided by A naught. A naught is the area at the I think this is wrong, right? Oh, here. The maximum stress also not here but here. Why? Because this is the smallest area, right? When the cross-sectional area becomes small, while the force constant, of course, this becomes the region of highest stress. That's understand. That's makes sense. Any questions so far? Come on.
Not yet, sir.
I will give you homework later, okay? Regarding the strong form, not yet finite element, because we not yet discussed about finite element. But first, it's good before proceed to formulation of the finite element to be familiar with the behavior of the bar through the solutions of the through analytical solutions, because these are easy. If not easy, of course, I will not do this. Okay. I mean, I will not discuss about analytical solutions. Okay, the second one. Now, use finite element. Okay. The finite element that we know already, that bar, right? Bar element, right? Bar in 1D space. So compute the displacement and stress at the right end here of the bar. I mean, what I want is the displacement here and not the stress. By modeling the bar using finite elements, two not finite elements that we know already. Let's take as before, the area of each element is taken to be the cross-sectional area at the midpoint of the element, okay, at the midpoint. So the representative area is the midpoint area. Let's say we, of course, when we use finite element, we should decide how many elements we use. Here in this problem, let's say we use one element. It means only have one element with the length LT. If we use two elements, we can, if we divide equally, of course, the length of element 1 and 2. This is not L square. Okay, please notice this is not L square, but element 1, element 2, 1, 2, 3. Okay. If we use 4 elements, this one. Okay. Okay. I will not discuss in details because this is the same as the direct stress method, right? simple direction is method. Which DSM are you going to use? If manual calculations, I strongly recommended you to use this DSMA, okay? Without removing the spot, a priori imposition upon recognition without removing the spot. That's efficient, right? Because only 1 degree freedom, and the stiffness matrix is just a number, and then we can obtain the displacement of this one immediately. Once we know the displacement, immediately we can calculate the stress, okay, for this problem. Only one element. So sigma 1, it means element number 1 is this one. The area of this element, of course, the area at the middle. This is 3, this is 1. So this is at the middle equals 2, okay, 2a0. That's if you use one element, we get the displacement 1/2, stress is 1/2. Okay, 0.5. How about if we use two elements here? I think we did this, right? When I explained about bar element as one of the example. So I will not go into the details, just recall that from the directions method, actually directions method is finite element method, right? Implementation of the finite element method. The active degree freedom for this problem is 2. We obtain the displacement like this. So it's 8 over 15, the displacement at this point, right? 8 by 15. And the stress is this one, 2/3. Okay, the stress at this point. Because the stress along the one element is constant, so we can compute the stress also this one. Okay, if we plot before comparing the stress, if we plot the displacement from finite element and the exact displacement that we know from here, okay, but we obtain like this, okay. This is the unit is FLT over EA0, it means in this unit, okay. I just see the numbers without this one. So if we use two elements, at the left end is 3 over 15. 3 over 15 is here. 315, right? Here. The pink one, sorry. The finite element solution is the blue one. At the middle, at the right end, so this is at 1 LT, 1 is mean 1 LT. This is 8.15, right? Yeah, at 15. How about the other place? If we use two node finite element, the other place is just linear interpolation from the node. So this is 0, this is 3.15, right? Before 3.15. So it's just straight line here. This 3.15, this 8.15, this is straight line. That's finite element solution. In other words, finite element solution gives piecewise linear. Piecewise, it means element wise, right? For each element linear. We will learn later. Okay. For two node bar element, it gives displacement of piecewise linear like this. If we plot the exact solution, we plot this one. This is x, right? The variable. Others I take 1, so it's become like the graphs is the graphs of pink color here. The pink color curve. What your opinion? What's your comments regarding finite element solutions? Satisfactory? Come on, give comments. If you see these graphs,
I think it's quite satisfactory.
Very satisfactory, right? Because only use two elements, very accurate, very close to exact solution. This is not the same, but very close. Not the same, not the same, but very very near each other, right? That's the displacement. Unfortunately, not for the stress. The exact stress, the distribution is smooth like this. Okay. However, and unfortunately, the finite element solution give constant stress because we know that this one is 0.4, right? 0.4 is constant along this one. So I plot here 0.4, the stress constants for the first element. The second element, we read from here, 2/3 stress, 2/3, and I plot this applicable for element number 2. It means for this one. And then I plot here. This is 2/3, it's around 0.67, right? The exact solution is is like this. It means that the prediction of the finite element at the nodes, at this element node, is quite far from the true solutions. The true solution is here. The correct solution is here. However, if we average, take the average, for example, I calculated the average, becomes very close, right? So usually if we have lower order finite element like this, we take the average usually, okay, for the stress. Except in the ends, we cannot take the average at the ends of the bar. We can just predict here from the boundary conditions, not from the element information, and here from the spot reactions. That what we can do to make our research accurate, right? Another comments regarding this graph is, okay, the most accurate one, it seems at the middle of each element, right? At the middle is element is very accurate, even exact, okay? Around in the middle of the element. So usually, if we have linear element, it's good to sampling, to take sample of the stress at the element centroid. That give them usually the most accurate results. Okay, the optimally accurate results. Another comment is that it's typical that the displacement based finite element always gives accurate solution for displacement, but less accurate solution for stress. Why? Because the primary variable that obtained first is the displacement. Stress is just the derivative of the displacement, so that's why it's become less accurate. Okay, this is typical, not only for this problem. Typical for displacement-based finite element. The most popular finite element is the displacement-based finite element that I'm teaching to you. Okay, actually there are other types of finite element, for example stress-based or mixed finite element, but that's not popular. And I will not discuss that. That's useful for some problems, but for bar problem, I think it's not necessary to go into that. Well, now after looking at the graphs, now how about the accuracy of the displacement and stress at the right end? Okay, the maximum displacement and stress. At the right end. Well, the exact solution is like this. 0.5493 FLT A over A not E, right? That's the displacement. The finite element solution, if we use one element, we know already 0.5 here, right? From here. If we use two, 8 over 15, it's more than 0.5 a little bit, okay? That's 0.5333. And if we use four elements, I didn't calculate manually, but use program, the program that in my book, okay, to solve four elements, eight elements, 16 elements, we can calculate the displacement like this. And regarding the error, this one, the error. The error I define as the finite element solution minus the exact solution divided by normalized to the exact solutions. It's minus because it means the finite element solution is less than the exact solutions. minus is mean that this solution is less than its exclusion. Please notice, when I make double the numbers of elements, the error decrease significantly, okay, from around 9% to around 3%. Around how many times? 3 times, right? And then when I move from, I change from 2 to 4, it means double. I double the numbers of elements. How about the error? This is about how many times? 0.8. Between 3 and 4 times, right? And this is 4 times, from 4 to 8. The tendency is that when the numbers of elements large enough, when we double the elements, the errors becomes decreasing. The error decreases in the order of square of the number of increase of the number of element. Okay, so this is if two times, this is 4 times. Okay, the tendency is like that. That's for the displacement. How about for stress? For stress is a little bit difficult to convert. Convert is mean to go towards the exact solutions when we refine the mass or when we increase the number of elements. This is from 1 to 2. The error from 50% to 33.33%, and then 1 to 4. Okay. This is, it means 4 times, but this is not 4 times, then very, very slow convergence of the stress. Up to 16 elements, we just reach 0.94. The stress at the right end. Well, in practice, of course, we don't do like this to obtain the stress, because we usually take on the right end is from the data from the spot reactions. That's exact, right? This is just evaluation regarding the stress if we take directly the values of the stress at the right end. At the left end, sorry. Oh, this is on the right end, right? Sorry, yes, on the right end, because this is at x equal LT, the maximum stress. Well, quite interesting, right? So we learned that finite element solution give accurate results for displacement, but not very accurate results for the stress. It means to obtain accurate results for stress, we need last number of elements or use another methods, not calculating like this. For bar, it's possible that we can obtain exact stress, exact displacement, exact stress. You can see in my book. I will not discuss here. Okay. So what I don't discuss in my lecture, for enhancements of your knowledge, you can read my book. What I discuss in this lecture is only the important parts, basic and important parts of the finite element. Any questions? Well, we can solve this because the loading is only axial force at the right end, right? No, actually distributed force. How about the elements have axially distributed force and also undergoes, for example, temperature change? How to solve that? We not yet discuss. Okay, we'll be coming soon. Okay. Any questions regarding the governing equations before we discuss another concept, important concept for finite element? That's about energy, strain energy. Okay, what is energy? Energy in general is the capacity or ability to do work. What is work then? In physics, we know that the work is a product of a force and a distance in the direction where the force moves. Or more precisely, a force is a vector, right? And the motion or the displacement is also a vector. In other words, the work is the dot product, actually. Dot product of the force, dot product to the displacement vector. So we can write like this. The work is force vector dot dot product dot, dot product of the displacement vector. So that's about energy and work in general terminology, right? In, but in the theory of elasticity, we define what is called elastic strain energy, okay? Elastic strain energy or elastic deformation energy. What is this? This energy, of course, energy stored in solid body when the body is in the deformed state. So if we have an elastic body, for example, rubber or even a steel, right? Steel, and then we apply, for example, the force like before, tension force like this, and then the steel will deform a little bit, small deformation, right? In the body, in the body of the steel, it stores energy. The energy stored is called strain energy. Okay. Another definition is the capacity of internal force or stresses to the work through deformation or strain the solid body. So initially it's in the undeformed condition, and then we let's say the normal force perform work until the final deformed state, from initial configuration to the final configurations. That the definition of the elastic strain energy. Okay, so let's say if we have a body, whatever the body, don't have to be a bar, okay? Any body like this, maybe in 3D is fine. Okay, this is, let's say, X, this is Y, this is Z, okay? And then we take a small part of the body. Oh, sorry, this is Y, this is Z, following this one. Small part of the body, very small. The length of this is dx, this is dy, the height, this is dz, don't have to be equal, okay? So maybe in general, this is a box, don't have to be a cube. We assume that, let's suppose that the only stress components that apply, that available in this particle, in this material, is normal stress, sigma x, is the stress in the x direction, sigma s, and in the condition of tension, this is sigma x, this is sigma x constants, and in the condition of tension, we want to calculate the strain energy to deform this particle, okay? That's we call du. The strain energy to deform this particle, that's we call du. What is strain energy by definition? How to calculate the strain energy in this small body? By definition, is the norm, the work of the normal force, of the force in that perform from undeformed state, undeformed configuration, to the deformed configurations. So first let me calculate the force, that I call Nx. This is normal to this one, right? What's the force? The force is the stress, or this one, multiplied by the area. What's the area? Dz dy, okay, or dy dz. This is the area. of this one. Okay. So this is the normal force. And then the normal force perform works, makes the element, this element, okay, or this body, to deform from this state. Let's say this is initial state to become like this, for example. For example, okay. We just put in here the displacement zero. Okay. So there is the extension of this body because of the force. So this is called delta x, the elongation of the body due to normal force. Okay. The elongation of, given by the strain times dx. Dx is this one. Strain in x direction dx. Okay. Well, this is the definition of the work. Because we don't have any information regarding how the normal force, what's the magnitude of the normal force during when it make the body deform. In other words, in general, the normal force is a function of deformation state. So we can plot, for example, a curve like this. This is delta x, the elongation of the small body. If this small body, this is the normal force, right? For example, the curve can be anything, maybe like this, okay? We don't know. In general, just we say that normal force is function of the delta x, okay? So I make statement here that the work done from the undeformed state, it means from unstretched or delta x zero, to the final deformation state, let's say the final is delta xf, okay? That's equal to epsilon x final dx by the normal force. So the work done by the normal force is we can, how to calculate the work when this equation is applicable for constant force, right? And yes, constant force. But if the force is not constant, actually we should integrate, right? The general formula is actually if when the force is not constant, we should integrate. Oh, dd, right? For the along the path, let's say L, okay? This is the general formula for performing the force when the force is not constant. So here we should integrate from the state of the deformation zero to the final of the normal force function, okay? D delta X. Is it clear? Maybe you learn this in physics, right? Basic physics. Didn't you? You learned this, right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, right? The work of the force when the force is not constant. We should integrate. Well, let's re-express the Let's re-express the what is delta x? Delta is epsilon dx, okay? Epsilon dx, but later, okay? This is just a change of variable. I want to change the variable from delta x to epsilon x. And then what is normal force? Normal force is the function of delta x. This is not multiply. This is normal force function delta x. Normal force is sigma x times dy dz. You can see here. Because this is function of delta x, of course, sigma x also function of delta x. Or we usually express the sigma x is function of the strain. Okay. So, but delta x is epsilon x dx. So from here, if we want to calculate d delta x, this is just the differential of this one. This is constant, right? dx is just the length of this one, it's constants. So we take the derivative differential d delta x, we assume dx is constants, and then we get this one, right? D delta epsilon d delta x equals d epsilon x dx. Okay. So this is d delta x. So we can replace this with this one, d epsilon dx dx. And how about this one? When we change the variable, we also should change the integral boundary. That's in calculus, right? Because we change the variable, we want to change the variable from delta x to epsilon x. Don't forget, we have also to change the boundary, the limits of the integrals, the outer boundary of the integrals. When delta x zero, when delta x zero, from this equation, we know that epsilon x should be zero. Okay, so this is zero. Of course, this is zero. But when delta x is delta x final, delta x f, okay, then from these equations, I think this is final, delta x final. Of course, the epsilon also, this one also final. So this is epsilon x f dx, okay, final. So we change the variables using this one. How about dx? Dx I put inside letter, so this becomes like this. Become like this. So this is delta d delta x become d epsilon x dx. This is constants. We can take outside integrals dy dz also constants because the variable integration, this is function of epsilon. So this is, we can write like this. But what's this? What's dx dy dz? What's dx dy dz? It's the volume of the this body, right? The volume of this body. So that's the volume, which we can write like this. So the work done by the normal force is the volume of the body times this integral. Okay, the integral of the stress with respect to strain. Okay, this one. This is the work done by the normal force. This work is by definition is the strain energy, right? The strain energy of the infinitesimal element or the box, the small box. That's I call du. Okay. In other words, if we calculate the strain energy per unit volume, that's we call the strain energy density, right? So this is called the strain energy density. This is the definition of strain energy density. Okay, the strain energy density is the strain energy per unit volume. Okay, this one. What's this? Actually, as I mentioned before, the in general stress is the function of strain. So we can draw a graph of this function. For example, this one. Okay, this is epsilon. This is sigma. This is the stress strain diagrams, including temperature effect. It means when the stress is zero, there is already strain due to the change of temperature. That's epsilon T, the strain due to temperature change. Okay. And what is integral here? The integral here, it means the area, actually this area, right? This is positive area, this is negative area. So the total area of this one. That's the strain energy density, U naught. Okay, I use the U naught symbol to denote the strain energy density of the small particle of material. Okay, this one. It's called the strain energy per unit volume, strain energy density. It's equal to the area under stress strain curve and above the strain axis. If we want to calculate not only the strain energy of a small particle within the body, but the whole body, we should integrate this one, right? We should integrate the U naught for the whole body. So this is the strain energy. How we can calculate the strain energy? In summary, we can calculate the strain energy if we know the stress-strain relationship. And then we calculate the strain energy density, and then we integrate it to obtain the whole, the strain energy of the whole body. In the volume integration, right? This is the volume integrals. That's the formula in general. If a volume body subjected to tension only, right? Tension only. There is no other force. Later we will learn if how about if there is other force. Well, in our case, this is general. In our case, our stress-strain relationship, our stress and strain relationship or constitutive equations given by the Hooke's law, right? Because we assume linear elastic materials subjected to temperature change like this. We can plug in this into this one, okay? Plug in this. So I plug in this one into the calculate strain energy density. And then integrate this one with respect to the epsilon x, we get this one. So this is the formula to obtain the what?
Energy density.
Strain energy density, right? Well, you know the stress. The stress is actually, can we express in terms of the stress? E epsilon x minus alpha t. It seems we cannot directly express in this in terms of the stress, right? Because this is different, order. This is without 1/2. This is 1/2, right? Yes. It seems no, cannot. Okay. So let the expression is like this. Okay. If we want to calculate the strain energy of the whole body, just integrate it over the volume, for example, volume of the bar. And for the bar, this is in general to a particular case, right? We know that what is dV? dV is a volume of the, we can regard it as small like this. This is dx, this is A. And we can take just the corresponding area, okay? So dV is adx, and the variable x is goes from 0 to L for this case. So this is the strain energy. Okay, this is the strain energy density for bar. So if you want to calculate the strain energy of the bar, just use this formula. Okay, linear elastic bar. Any questions?
So with this formula, the cross sectional area is assumed to be constant.
Don't have to be constants, okay? Can be non-prismatic, can be for non-prismatic. Oh. Can be a function of x. But, yes, for tapered part, but not too tapered. If too tapered, it's not applicable, or the strain energy you calculate, maybe it's not the actual strain energy.
What if the cross-sectional area change, you know, shrink or getting bigger? So it is assumed to be constant.
No. This is can be of again. This is can be a function of x. In other words, you can have, you may have, any shape. For example, like this. Okay. This cross-sectional area is a function of x. Okay, so this is in general can be a function of x, but again not to be far away from the straight one because that's will not accurate because this is based on the assumption of the bar, because when the bar is too tapered, too far away from the prismatic, the deformation of the cross section is not longer plane, remain plane. The basic assumption of the bar is cross-sectional plane remain plane. Okay, so the deformation is this to this. But if this too tapered, imagine the bar like this, and then you pull here. Maybe the deformation is not straight to straight, but maybe it become like this, right? The deformations. So this is violate the bar assumptions. Don't too tapered like this. We can check later using another models, okay?
Okay, thank you, sir.
So it's applicable when there is slightly taperedness of the bar. Okay, let's let me give some example, two examples actually from the previous one. The first example is from taken from the previous one because we know already the results, right? To calculate the strategy. From the results in the previous problem, we already obtained the strain like this. Believe me, this one, okay. I copy from here. The strain here, okay. Specimen strain. I just copy here this and then put here. Okay, strain. We calculated the strain already. Okay, in the bar. Okay, x from 0 to L. Please calculate the strain energy for this bar. This is prismatic case, right? It means the A is constants. For the case, for three cases, let's say this is not zero, but this is the first case is without this one. Without this one, without also T. Okay, the first case. The second case is T only. And the third case is P only, small P only. This is the, so this is 1, 2, 3. Please calculate the strain energy. Okay, let me take rest a moment while Miss Angeline, please fill in the attendance list, okay, for this course.
Okay, sir.
If you have any questions regarding these concepts, governing questions or strain energy, please, you may ask and prepare a question, okay? I will take rest about 5 to 10 minutes.
Thank you.
Hello, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Are you ready? Any questions? So we are going to determine the strain energy of this bar. We know the strain. It's easy because we can use this formula immediately. Right? This is the strain. Right? We know others. We know. Well, for the first problem, T is equal to zero, P equal to zero. It means we only have this one, right? This is zero. This is zero. We don't have only this one for the strain for the first case. Okay. We only need this information. So this is 1/2 E epsilon square. Okay. From these equations. We don't need this because P is equal to zero for the first case. Just 1/2 this one. And then this is constants, this is all constants. The rest are constants, right? So we can take out of integrals. The integrals of dx from 0 to L is the length. Okay, of the bar, so we get this result. Maybe you already know this result, right? 1/2 V square L AE for the bar subjected to concentrated force. So this is useful if you want to calculate the strain energy in the truss, maybe your 3D truss. For example, I ask you, calculate the strain energy in your truss. What should you do? You can use this formula directly, right? You know the area of its bar, its members, the truss. Of course, you know E. You know L, the length of this member. And then you know the normal force for its members. So the total strain energy, of course, just the summation of this one, okay? Summation of the of this quantity. For all of the members in the truss, you may apply this for 2D truss, for example, 2D truss in the mid-semester exam, or 3D truss, okay, to calculate strain energy. So this is useful formula. So I put in the box. It's useful formula. How about the second case? Let me clean. For the second case, we only consider this one because the rest are zero. So going to here, let me clean first. So only consider this minus, this is zero, right? Oh, no, 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 not zero. Let it be like this. So E epsilon X, E alpha, T epsilon. Okay, that's for the second case. But in the second case, from the from this results, we know that if this zero only this, so epsilon is alpha t, there is no stress, and then we can plug in the this results to the formula, 1/2 e alpha t square minus e alpha t square becomes minus 1/2 a e alpha t square integrals, all are constants, right? Because in this problem all are constants. So this is L. So this is the answer. Negative. So the strain energy due to temperature only without any force is negative. Why? I think this is because of what? Because when the body deform, it absorb heat energy, right? It absorb heat energy. It deform but by itself without doing any mechanical works. In other words, the body receive heat energy but release the strain energy, releases, not absorb. It's different from if we do mechanical works. If we do mechanical works, the body absorb positive, it means absorb the energy, mechanical energy. But this is the body release the energy, the mechanical energy. The energy that get from heat energy, it release in the forms of strain energy. Okay, so that's why it's negative. I think like that. Only due to temperature, due to mechanical force always positive. For example, the third case, only due to distributed force. So this drop, we can drop this, and then epsilon become like this. I think sigma on it, just 1/2 E, because there is no temperature change, we can drop this term, right? Okay, 1/2 E epsilon x squared for the third case. All of the constants we can take out side of the integrals. That's p square a e square e, okay, and then integrals of this. Then we obtain integrals of this is l cube over 3. So the result is p square l cube 6 a e. This is the strain energy absorbed by the bar because of the XLD loaded force. Any questions? Just a little bit calculation of the integrals. Not difficult, right?
Sir?
Yes?
Maybe I forgot the reason, but why the stress of temperature strain is assumed to be zero? Because I think some element can experience thermal expansion and contraction.
Pardon. I didn't get what you mean.
Maybe I kind of forgot the reason, but why the stress of the temperature is
ignored? Not the stress. This is not stress. This is the strain energy.
No, the sigma equals zero at the T only.
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, from this research. The previous research, of course. Sigma, right?
Yes.
Because of temperature, there is no effect temperature here. So if it's P zero, the load, all of the loading zero, it means the stress zero. Because this is the structure is statically determinate, right? Statically determinate. If we have a statically determinate structure, there is no effect of the temperature to the temperature increase or decrease doesn't induce stress. Okay. Oh. But if you fix, yes, there is stress. There will be stress. Okay. That's the reason. Or maybe I can give you a problem like this in the exam, for example. This is spring. And then there is temperature change. That's the stiffness of the spring K. There will be some stress. Okay. If the problem like this. Or the problem is fix. You can imagine that if we make the bar is hotter, the bar just become longer, right? Existence, but doesn't have any stress because it's statically determinate. Okay, that's the reason why.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Zero stress, but not zero strain energy, okay? It's negative strain energy. Because this one, right? Negative. This is the area, it's negative, this one. The area. I can give interpretation that it releases the release it releases the strain energy. For the energy absorbed from the heat energy releases in the form of strain energy. Next example. Please calculate the strain energy of this bar. This is not prismatic. If prismatic, we know already, right? The result, right? The result is if this prismatic, let's say this is 2A naught, the strain energy will be what? F square LT over 2 times A naught E, right? Following this formula, right? Square L over 2AE. Is this correct? If we take in the middle, is this the same? No, the answer is not. This is what? Equals 1/4 or FLT square A naught E. This is equal to 0.5 of this one. But this is not zero exactly to, not exactly to 0.5. It's 0.747. So it's more than if we take this one as the fresh area. A little bit has to be higher, okay? A little bit higher than the representative area. Proof that this is the exact solution for the strain energy for this bar, okay? For not, of course, this is cannot be not too tapered. Okay. Recall from the previous example that in this problem we have non-prismatic bar. It means the area is function of x. This is the constants, the area of the at the yes, a kind of unit area here. A zero. This is 3 a zero, right? And this is 2 a zero. And from the previous result, this is the epsilon, this is the sigma. This is I just write down the copy or write down the previous research here. I copy the previous research here and then use this to calculate the strain energy. So we already know what is epsilon, what is sigma, but the important thing is epsilon. Okay. Oh, this is without temperature change, so it's easy, right? Just use this formula. 1/2 sigma epsilon A dx, but recall that A here is not constants. Maybe you asked me before this one, right? This one, not constants, function of x. Sigma also, you can just copy this one, plug in into this. And then all of the constants, we can, we multiply first, we make it simple. So become like this, okay? Because we can eliminate this one, actually. We can cancel out this one with this one and I think this one. I don't know. I get this one, okay? I calculate and get this one, but all of the constants and then I put outside and then make it like this and then integrate this. How to integrate this? That's a little bit difficult. For this one, I use another variable. Let's psi. Usually in mathematics, use u, right? You may use u, but I didn't use u since I already use u for displacement. I use psi. This is just to change the variables. And then don't forget, each time you change the variables, you should change dx to become lt d psi. Okay, and you should also change the integration boundaries because this is when x 0, c is 0, okay? When x LT, c is 1. So this is how we, in calculus, we calculate this integrals. And then the integrals of this now is easy because LT is constants. Just natural log of this one divided by this one, 1 over minus 2 from 0 to 1. And then the final result, we just plugin 1 and plugin 0 in then here. And then this is natural log of 1, 0, minus become plus, right? Become like this. And then use calculator or MATLAB. Approximately is equal to 0.2747. It's a little bit bigger than 1/4, okay? If we take the mid coastal area. Well, any questions? From these examples, how to calculate strain energy in the bar. No? Okay, good. Well, what so far we discussed is what so called the strong form of the governing equations. Why is called strong form? Because when we talk about differential equations, the differential equation is equilibrium equation of the small body, right? A small segment of the bar. It should be applicable for each small segment. Have strong requirement to be like that. Now we are going to construct another method to express the equilibrium of the body, of the bar in this case. Okay, we use what's so called the principle of virtual world, or more precisely the principle of virtual displacement, because actually there are two types of principle. This principle, one is principle of virtual displacement, the other is the principle of virtual force. Okay, what is virtual or imaginary? In this is the synonym, the same words, imaginary displacement. That's not actual. Okay, this is in virtual is the opposite of actual. It's an imaginary, and we regard very small change in the configuration of the system. So if we have a system bar in this case, and then we disturb a little bit, this is already in the condition of equilibrium under the subjected to force, some forces and temperature, and then we disturb a little bit, that's we perform virtual displacement actually, okay? The principle of virtual work, or more precisely, the principle of virtual displacement is as follows. This is the sentence. This is the statement. If a body, let's say a bar, okay, in this context, in equilibrium, then what happened? Is subjected to arbitrary virtual displacements. So again, imagine if we have a bar, and then I disturb a little bit to any arbitrary virtual displacement, but the virtual displacement should be continue, okay, this compatible, and satisfy the boundary conditions. That's compatible deformation of the body. Then what happened? The fact is that the virtual work of external forces, okay, on the body is equal to the virtual strain energy of the internal stresses. Again, the virtual work of the external force, okay, is equal to the virtual strain energy of the internal stresses. The word compatible here, or admissible displacement, are those that satisfies the boundary conditions, or displacement boundary conditions actually, and satisfy the continuity. In other words, there is no discontinuity, such as voids overlaps during the deformations. You understand what I mean? I'm sure not yet, okay? Don't worry. You will understand later, one by one, okay? Little by little, I mean. So, this is in symbol, okay? If I have a bar, a body, or let's say in this context, a bar, subject to some forces and temperature change, and then the bar is in the condition of equilibrium, static equilibrium, okay, then if I disturb a little bit by any compatible virtual displacement or admissible displacement, it should be the internal virtual strain energy delta U. This is U is the delta U is the virtual strain energy or virtual strain energy of the internal stresses is equal to the virtual work. This is virtual work of the external forces. So this is internal, this is external. Internal, external. Internal stress, this is external force. This is the work of internal stresses. This is the work of external force. A kind of balance, right? A balance of the work. Internal and external should be in balance for any virtual displacement. Is it more clear now? Is it clearer now? Not yet. Okay, don't worry, because this is difficult, right? Anyway, have you learned this principle before in other than finite element subject? Let me know.
I think so.
Please speak louder. I cannot hear your voice.
I think so, sir.
In what subject?
Mechanics of material.
Maybe I don't know, but here we learn again for the purpose of the finite element formulation. Okay. So here I explain. Let's say I have a bar. Okay, it's the bar. This is fixed here, so the displacement is zero. The actual displacement. We have two types of displacement: actual and virtual, right? This is the actual displacement is zero. And then this is the graphs. Let's say we have the solution here. So this is the displacement at the right end. This is the displacement at the left end. This is the graphs. So we draw a graph of the function. This is x, this is u, right? And then we disturb the body, the bar. I disturb a little bit. So that's the virtual displacement. Okay, virtual displacement is a kind of change in displacement a little bit. So I change a little bit. This is the delta u, virtual displacement. Also a function, right? A function. This change is a function. This is the virtual displacement at the right end. This is the virtual displacement at the left end. Compatible, it means I make the change is also continuous to become continuous function. There is no discontinuities. Okay. From continue to continue. And on the right, on the left end, I mean, it's zero, always zero. So it's always zero on the displacement boundary condition. That's what I mean, admissible, admissible virtual displacement. Okay. An example of non-admissible, for example, in opposite of admissible, the contradiction of the admissible, for example, the displacement is like this. After I disturb, become like this. Okay, this is in zero, but this is discontinue here. This is example of in or not admissible. In admissible maybe. Admissible or not admissible. Because discontinue, right? Or continue, but become like this. Okay, this is continue, but this is not zero, negative something. Okay, delta u at zero is not zero, so it's not compatible or not admissible. Incompatible on not admissible. Okay, displacement. We cannot test with inadmissible displacement. We should test with admissible displacement. Okay. Okay. Let's go to specific problem now. Again, let's reconsider this bar again. How to write the principle of virtual displacement specifically for this problem? The principle says that, oh yeah, this bar is in equilibrium, so the internal virtual strain energy is equal to the virtual work of the external forces. But what is this? How to calculate this one? recall the definition of strain energy without, let's say, without temperature. With temperature sense, the strain energy is given by, for elastic, linear elastic material, 1/2 E epsilon square, or 1/2, yes, let me write like this, A dx, right? But this is equal to, without temperature change, A epsilon, epsilon dx, but this is sigma, right? Sigma, 1/2 sigma is epsilon. This is the definition for actual strain energy. But this is not actual, this is virtual. Virtual is without 1/2. So without 1/2, okay, here. Stress, virtual strain. Okay, this is stress, virtual strains. This is ADX. This is called virtual strain. What is virtual strain by definition? Is the derivative of the virtual displacement. Because strain is derivative of the displacement. So virtual displacement is derivative of the virtual displacement. Please notice that this is without 1/2. The question is why? Why should don't have 1/2? 1/2 here is comes from the assumptions of linear elastic, right? Linear elastic like this, without temperature change. Like this, strain, stress. So this is make it 1/2 because the strain energy density is, let's say this is up to this sigma and this is up to this epsilon. So this is 1/2 sigma epsilon with the area of these triangles, right? This is the height is sigma, the base is epsilon. So that's the area. But this is without 1/2 because when we perform, when we disturb the, this is the displacement is u, right? And then we disturb by delta u. The final displacement is becomes like this. Because of this perturbation or disturbance, there is the change in the strain from epsilon to epsilon plus delta epsilon become here, right? What I mean by virtual strain energy is we assume that the stress remains constant. So the stress remains constant during the virtual displacement. So that's we call virtual displacement, not actual. Not actual displacement. We assume that during virtual displacement, the work during virtual displacement, the stress remains constant. So the work is here. Let me use another color. Here, this is delta u, and the delta u, this is delta epsilon, right? So stress times delta epsilon, stress remain constant times delta epsilon. That's the reason why it's without 1/2, because the answer is we assume that stress remains constant during the deformation due to virtual displacement. That's the answer for this question. Any questions? Okay, how about on the right hand side? We already defined this one, right? How about on the right hand side? On the right hand side is the external virtual work. Again, imagine that we disturb a little bit. Then the work of this force, what? Force, what is work? Force time displacement, right? This is P time displacement. But not actual, but virtual displacement. We call delta U. So this is force times displacement. The virtual displacement at here. So this is U at the virtual displacement at L. This is the work of this one. How about the work of this one? We take a little segment, bar segment, And then we have force here, right? P, we assume that's constants. And then because of the vertical displacement, this moves, what's the force? This is actually force per unit length. The force is PdX, right? That's the force times the vertical displacement, delta X, delta U, sorry. So this is the vertical displacement of this part. For the whole part, we should integrate from 0 to L, PdX, delta UX. Any questions regarding how to define the virtual strain energy and the virtual work of external forces? So the principle say that the internal strain energy, internal virtual strain energy should be equal to the virtual work of external forces. Yes, we can change this one for if there is temperature change, this one, right? So this is the equations of the virtual work. The integral equation, not differential equation, integral equation. This integral should applicable for all delta U. So now we it's clear that we have two ways we can state the problems. Okay, the first one is the strong or classical form. The statement is goes like this: given all the data, the geometric material data, and also the forces, the temperature change, then including the support conditions, okay, find the displacement, okay, field such that satisfy this one, right? That's calculus, right? Or differential equation way. We solve differential equations plus the boundary conditions that we did before. Using the principle of virtual displacement, we have alternative form like this. Okay, given the same data, okay, material data, geometrical data, spot conditions, find what? Find compatible. We find a continuous U, point the displacement such that the solutions, if we can find, satisfy these equations for all virtual displacement, for all admissible virtual displacement. Okay, for all admissible virtual displacement. Again, I should say again, given all of the data, the required data, find the compatible displacement or a solution. That zero in here already. In a such way that these equations applicable for all admissible disturbance. I mean virtual displacement. Okay. This is the weak. We call this is the weak or personal form in contrast to the strong or classical form. Why is called the weak? Because we see that. We state the equilibrium not point by point, but in the integral sense. Okay, in the integral sense like this. The second reason is mathematical reasons. This is called strong form because it has second derivative. It means the function it here is should be differentiable two times, right? Because this is second derivative, the should be two times differentiable, but here should be only one time differentiable. And yes, one time differentiable here. It means the requirement is not as strong as this one. The requirement of the continuity requirement. This is called weak form. Okay, weak form of the governing equations. Okay, that's about the bar model, we have two statements, weak form and strong form. And to develop finite element, we use strong form, weak form as the basis of the finite element method. So we will use this to formulate the finite element method for bar, okay? So this is the basis of the finite element method. The weak statement of the problem is the basis of the finite element methods. Any questions? I know that this is maybe the hardest part of this lecture, one of the hardest part to understand. You should digest it slowly. Okay, let's continue. Any questions so far? Please, if you have any questions, or maybe still confused. Any comments? Please. You should read my book, okay? To enforce your understanding, and then you should do your homework to understand this.
Sir?
Yes.
Is delta ux a given equation or what?
Ux? You mean the displacement, this one?
The delta ux, the
virtual. Delta ux, the virtual displacement.
Yeah.
This one. This one. This one. Delta ux. Delta ux is a function. Arbitrary functions. Called test function. It means if you say to me, I have the solutions. You have the solutions. Satisfying the correct solution. I can test. Okay. If you have solution, for example, you say, oh, ux is sinus x. Maybe you say like that is a solution. Okay, I can test. Put this one to here, and then I choose. I can test using any function. If I find one function that make it incorrect, this equation incorrect, that's what you said. What you say is not true. Okay, not a correct solution. That's a kind of like testing like this. So this is called test function, right? Arbitrary function. It contains two functions actually. U is the solutions, and delta U is the test functions, a kind of testing. For example, if I have a bar, is this in equilibrium or not? Oh, I disturb a little bit. If it's returned to equilibrium positions, it's okay. It's true in equilibrium, right? Because if not, if I disturb a little bit, and then that's unstable, right? A kind of delta u is a function that disturbance of the displacement. That's the physical understanding of the delta u. Perturbation, a kind of perturbation.
So the process is kind of like an iteration process.
Yeah, not really iteration, but kind of testing. You propose a solution, and then test. Okay. We test with delta U, kind of like that. In finite element method, we use this. Later, we propose a solution, we approximate, and then U, and then we also test with the same form of the function. That in the finite element method, okay? Later, you will understand. We will not use this for deriving an exact solutions, no. But we will use this for as the basis of formulating the finite element equations.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, well, it seems a little bit surprising. We have very different form, right? This one and this one looks like very different, but actually, these statements should be equivalent. Otherwise, nonsense. If this statement and these statements is different, it's not equivalent, it's nonsense, right? So I have a theorem here. Here I just state the theorem like this: the equivalence of the strong and weak form. The strong form and the weak forms are equivalent in the sense that if you have a solution of the strong form, if U as solution of the strong form, then what? U is also a solution of the weak form. And conversely, if U a solution of weak form, then U is also a solution of strong form. In other words, they are equivalent. Otherwise, nonsense to use weak form, right? But what's the proof? I will not present the proof in this lecture, but in my book, there is mathematical proof of this. Please read my book, okay? If you want to see the proof. I write many things that I don't teach you here in my book, including the proof of the equivalence of these strong and weak forms. Otherwise, nonsense to talk weak form, right? Because it's different model. With this equivalence, we can sure make, we have confidence that if we develop a finite element, that finite element is will be an equivalence to a discrete equivalent of the strong form, right? Strong form solution. Okay. I think the time is up now, right? Almost up. Most of the time I talk about governing equations, strong form, weak form, but how to apply the weak form or personal equation to obtain the finite element solutions, or the finite element equations, the discrete equations. Okay, that's will be the subject of the next week. But the idea is like usual. Let's say I have a bar, and then as usual, the first step is discretization. It means we divide the bar into elements, right? We divide the bar, for example, for four elements like this. We give the numbers of element 1, 2, 3, 4. We give the name for degrees freedom, global degrees freedom, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5. And then the next is we can just isolate because this element is typical, right? And then we define also, as usual, we define also local coordinate system here. X1, X2, X3, X4. Please notice its element is typical. So I just can consider one typical element, for example, element 2, to talk about the formulation of the bar. Okay. One typical. Just, I just take among all of the elements, one typical element. Can be element 1, 2, 3, to talk, to formulate the formula, to discuss the formation of the bar. So that's I will do next week. So I just take one typical element. Maybe this is element number E. Okay, maybe I just took I just take element number 2, and then we know this is have local numbering system 1, 2, right? 1, 2. This is local coordinates. This is the axial force within the element. This is local degrees freedom. This is the applied nodal force to make the structure in balance, and then we will focus on this, and then to obtain the whole, later we will perform TSM. That's the way we will do to formulate the finite element. Okay. But the time is up, so see you next week. Don't forget, prepare for the exam about 3D truss.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay. I stop recording.